I've been asked to say something about roses and thorns. But when there was music about thorns, people did not come thinking that thorns may prick them. So I am just hesitating whether I should talk about roses or thorns. Let us see how many are there who go away thinking about the thorns. Thorns, of course, roses, that means joy of love. And thorns, joy of a pain of love. There is a great difference between the joy and the pain. In spiritual path, the joy and pain, they go simultaneously, hand in hand. When you have the pain, of course, you enjoy it. Worldly suffering, it causes pain, but you don't enjoy it. You want to get out of it. You don't enjoy. But in a spiritual path, this pain gives you such a joy that you suffer and still you want more suffering. This is the path, a spiritual path. It is so narrow that only one single person can go through it. It is so narrow. If you take the false self along with you, part two, there is no way. So narrow, only you can enter into the spiritual path through that real self. False self, it is there, but it becomes so weak that that real self does not enjoy the company of the false self. So this path is very, very narrow. Only it is for the single person. You cannot take false self along with you. And that's why when the false self, it is there, and we remain attached with our false self, and that's why the suffering is there. Sometimes the beloved appears very, very cruel, and people think, oh, he is infinite compassion. How the beloved is so cruel? He is not cruel. It is his infinite compassion makes him apparently to become cruel. I just tell you one example. It was in the year 1958. You all know that there was Sahwas program at Mehrabad. But before this Sahwas program, in 1956, 2nd December, Baba met with an accident. Dr. Nilu died, Pendu severely injured, and Arach, his ribs were broken, and Baba wanted the Sahwas program. And Sahwas program, when he wanted, of course, so it should be organized. From the beginning, Pindu was in charge of the program. He would always arrange the program, management would be in his hand. And in 1958, when the program was there, so before that, Baba wanted to discuss about the program. Pindu was sent to Mehrabad, and Dr. Donkin, he was giving him treatment exercise. Poor Pindu would not be able to walk. He would use crutches. So Pindu, Vishnu, Padri, and Dr. Donkin, they were at that time at Mehrabad. and Baba was in Mehrazad. Only few Mandli, Airach, Aloba, Kaka, and I was there with Baba because I was keeping night watch. So I was there. And Baba called Pendu, Padri, Vishnu, and Duncan to Mehrazad to discuss about the Sahwas program. At that time, Jimmy Mistri, who is now at Mehrabad, he is a trustee. For the first time, Baba had permitted him to stay at Mehrabad for some days. So he was new at that time, and Baba, they come. Baba was in the Manli hall. Airach was there and myself, only two persons. And Baba was in a very serious mood. Very, very serious mood. Now they come from Mehrabad. Poor Pendu, he was using the crutches and he was fumbling when he was entering into the Manli hall. We were sitting there, Airach and me. But we did not have that courage to give him some support, seeing Baba's mood, serious mood. So we were just sitting there and fumbling. Pendu came to the Manli hall and the discussion begins. What was the discussion? Baba says, this time I am going to manage this Sahwas program. He says to Pendu, I will not give this work to you. You just think of yourself. You think of your pain. You think of yourself. You don't think of me. And the man who thinks of himself, I cannot give such work to that person. You just go away. I don't care for you. And of course, I will manage myself. Do you know how much pain I am having? I am suffering. You are suffering for yourself. I am suffering for the whole mankind. Have you any idea about my suffering? Have you any idea about my pain? What I am passing through? Did you ever think about that? You just thought about your own pain, that you cannot sleep, you cannot walk. What about me? I also can't walk. I have got pain. And this pain, it is nothing. So even if you die, what is there? You don't think about me. I am suffering. You think about yourself. Go away. And Pendu wept and wept and wept. Serious atmosphere. Serious. And Baba says, I don't want you. Go there. Think about yourself. Think about your pain. Think about everything. Don't think about me. Go. And Pendu, Padri, Vishnu, and Duncan, they go back. And here sitting our Jimmy Mistri, he could not believe it was such a shock to him that he is all compassionate, all love. And what is this? He could not imagine such a thing. And Baba says to him, in order to become infinitely compassionate, I have to become infinitely cruel. So his cruelty, which we think that, oh, Baba was so cruel, so compassionate because of that, because of his compassion, he has to suffer and suffer. We follow different things. Oh, Baba is doing this and Baba is not helping. No one knows how he suffers for each one. It was not that he was so cruel to Pendu. It was his compassion. The best part of his compassion. Best part of his compassion he uses pain. It is really enjoyable. enjoyable. It is just like when you get itching, you scratch it. When you scratch it, you get pain, but still you enjoy it. You go on scratching. So it is like that. This is spiritual path. It is a path. Of course, it is beyond imagination. And only through love, one can enter. The real self takes along with it only love, not the desires, not the false self. Very, very difficult. It requires His grace. It requires His help. If we just think about Him, how He has passed through, we'll just forget everything. Oh, here is our beloved who is all the time with us. And what we think about Him, think about His cruelty, we go on interpreting different things which suits us. No, never think about that. Think about what He wants, how you should please Him. You have got, I tell you, there are some people, they think that how to please Baba when He is not physically present. When He was physically present, at that time, of course, those who were with Him, they knew that Baba was pleased and Baba was displeased. But now, how we should know that Baba is pleased? I tell you the story about Saint Meera. Saint Meera came, was there after thousands of years of Krishna. She was the queen. She was, the king was there and she was the queen and she was in the palace. But Krishna, all the time Krishna, she would not care for the world. She would not care for the kingdom. It is not that through thought, but it is the love which would make her to go out just on the street. So she would go on the street, she would just sing, she would be just going here and there. And it was too much for the king and his relatives to bear. King's sister, of course, she would feel so bad about it. Queen, and she just goes out like an ordinary person and sings on the street about Krishna. So they tried their best to check her. Wherever she did not know what she was doing, just Krishna, Krishna given poison. So the poison was given in glass. She was offered and she takes, Krishna, I am taking your prasad. Nothing happened. Then of course the torture from the family and torture now, they thought that now the poison of course did not affect her. So something should be done. So one day one cobra was put in the basket and on that cobra some flowers were there. And someone was saying to her that these flowers, they are for you. You just present to your Lord Krishna. And she was very happy, thinking, just see how this man, how kind that he brought flowers for my Krishna, for my Lord. She opens the basket and what was there? The cobra disappeared and only the flowers, the garland. And she, of course, garlanded Krishna. The queen, of course, then they thought that now this queen, this is no good. This is blasphemy to have such a person in the palace. Because she is mad. She does anything. She was driven out. And driven out, she did not know that for her palace and street and forest and nothing, just nothing but Krishna. Everywhere there was nothing but just Krishna. So what happens? She just goes on singing and singing. Where she was going, she did not know, but just Krishna, Krishna, Krishna all the time. And what happens? she goes to Vrindavan, the place of Krishna. And how did she go? Nobody knew. And then the search was made. The king, of course, wanted to find her. Search was made and it took years. And here was the queen Meera, just near the statue of Krishna, just Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. And then afterwards, they found that she was in Vrindavan, husband, the king, and the sister, who was all the time telling his her brother that you should get rid of her. They go there and they bow down to her. The love. When love is there, the kingdom of the whole world, it is just like dust. It has no meaning at all. It is just like dust before that love. And that is love. When the beloved comes, he wants to give. He is the ocean. And because he is the ocean, he wants to give the ocean. And when he wants to give, we hesitate. We think that, oh, this world is really very pleasant world, beautiful world. We must enjoy it to the fullest extent. I don't know how many times we have enjoyed this world and still we do not feel fed up with that. The attachment with the illusion, it was of that attachment. Attachment, nobody should be blamed for that. No one, but at least when we come to know about our beloved, when we recognize him, at least we should just try to follow his wish. There is another story about Sakhu. She became a saint. She was also married, and the mother-in-law, all the time after her, mother-in-law would give her lot of trouble. Her love, again Krishna, her love was pure. The husband, of course, when she would go to bed, husband would go, but that love was such that his desire of sex, it would just go away. Again he would come back, and then, of course, again he would just think that I should appear attractive towards her. So he would make up and different things so that she may be attracted towards him. He tried and tried. Every time he would go, of course, she would just find Krishna. She would find Krishna, and because of her love, his desire, he would forget at that time his desire and again come back. And he realized that yes, his wife, she is something else, and I must not touch her, I must not disturb her. But the mother-in-law was such that she would not allow her to eat. When she would be eating, she would say that now do this. She had to leave that, and the dogs or sometimes cats would come her to give her massage, and she would do that. And it went on and on and on. But her lord Krishna was all the time with her. The thorn, all the time thorns were there, and she belonged to the Lord. And one day, what happens? There is one place of pilgrimage in India, in Maharashtra, called Pandharpur. So there, certain day, there is a very big fair. Millions of people go there. So, and they go in the group walking. Sometimes hundreds of miles they walk in a group, and they go there. So when that time came, and one group was going from that place, Krishna, 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 she joined the group and she went away. She went to Pandharpur. But her mother-in-law finds that she was working in the house, and she was just after after her, do this and do that, all heavy work, cut the wood and then of course grind the grain, everything, wash the clothes. So Krishna was doing, Krishna was working there, and this Sakhu was in Pandharpur. And Pandharpur, when they came back, so one of the persons from the group comes and tells the mother-in-law that how is it that you allowed your daughter-in-law to go to Pandharpur? She said, no, I did not. My daughter-in-law is here. She said, no, she went to Pandharpur and she is coming with the group. You just go and see. She said, no, all the time she is here. What are you telling? She is here. No, no, she is just, she is there, she is coming, she is just Krishna, Krishna singing and she is coming, just go and see. So the mother-in-law goes and she finds, yes, her daughter-in-law was just singing. So who is that? Here is my daughter-in-law, here is my daughter-in-law. Oh, she said, oh Krishna, now I realized it was you who was working here, just please forgive me. I was after you all the time, and this happens because of the thorn. One faces difficulty, suffering to any extent, but that suffering you enjoy. So only thing make difference in worldly suffering and the suffering for the beloved, there is this difference, that suffering if you have because of the beloved and you derive joy, think that this is the suffering given by my beloved. But that suffering which you cannot enjoy and you want to get rid of that, then of course think that this is worldly suffering. Great difference. Suffering, when once you have that suffering, you enjoy and you want more and more. Taste for that pain which gives joy to you because you want the beloved, you long for his union, you want to be with him, and this pain itself, this suffering itself, inner suffering takes you towards him. So that thing which you want, which you long for it, it gives you joy. There are so many stories. So now you say how to please the beloved when he is not in physical body. Krishna was not there after thousands of years. Meera was there. So because of love, you don't, when that love comes, even you do not know whether beloved is pleased or not, he has to be pleased. Love, it is such a thing, if you love him, how can he feel displeased when you love him? When you love someone, that even in worldly level, what do we find? That when you love someone, whether he will feel displeased? No. When you love, of course, love makes one pleased. So the beloved, of course, what sacrifice it requires. But sacrifice, we don't want, we just want this, we want that, and we want that. Why not to just leave everything to him? We are in the world. We are also involved in the world. The problems are there. The difficulties are there, no doubt. But we are just suffering for the world. Why not to suffer for the beloved? And when we are suffering for the world, at least do not forget the beloved. We are there. Ask him that all I... these problems are there, please just solve that basic problem so that all the problems will be solved. Just make a room for him in the heart and then see what a strength you get. That strength, it is not that you will not suffer or physical suffering will not be there because you are following beloved Meher Baba. Of course, he is the avatar, so you should not suffer. Suffering, it is there is nothing. But why to suffer permanently for him? And that suffering will give you joy. this worldly suffering, they are there. All types of suffering, all types of problems, there is no end to it. Innumerable problems will be there, the difficulties will be there. But what is the basic thing, the problem of the life? If we just try to solve that problem, all the problems will be solved automatically, because nothing happens in reality. Everything happens in illusion. Whatever happens in the world, it is just in illusion, and that's why it is all false. Reality remains as such. Nothing happens in the reality. It is from it is eternal, remains as reality, no change, unchangeable. So that reality is in everyone, and that reality, when we want the reality and we want the illusion at one and the same time, we don't think that, oh beloved, make us free from that attachment. Our attachment is there, and because of that attachment, if he pricks the thorn, we don't want thorn, we want rose. So he gives rose also. It is not that he does not give rose. What he does, he just spreads his net to catch the birds. But to catch the birds, of course, he must also tempt them to come to the net. So what he just puts grain just away from the net, and the birds come and they eat. Then little closer and little closer and little closer, and the bird then become little bit fearless. Oh, we get grain. And in this way, he brings near the net. And when in the net, of course, when they are caught, then the beloved has all right, all authority to twist their neck and this, and then prick thorns, everything, because now you can't go out of that net. You are caught. So long he gives the grain to eat, you enjoy. The roses are there for you. You are not caught in the net, give, all right. Eat and enjoy. So when it is done, this happiness, when he gives, it is also given in order to catch in the net. Because the beloved, he is not like that. His work is just to catch in the net and twist. So that, you know, and when you die, you live eternally. So that is the thing, and that is the reality. So if you just ask falseness from him, how can he give? So he, in order to tempt you to go towards the reality, of course he gives happiness. All right, enjoy this, enjoy that. And then gradually he brings you towards the net. Once you are caught, then of course you can't do it. You cannot say that whether it is fair, unfair, whether it is reasonable, unreasonable, nothing, just twisting. He is not going to listen then. So long he is giving grain and you enjoy at that time, then of course you can just ask whether this is reasonable, unreasonable, whether he is fair, unfair, talk about anything. And that's why, so long he gives roses, of course he gives you happiness. Yes, come, yes, take more, eat more, enjoy. You don't know what he is doing. So you all will be just caught in the net. Now think about anything, because you are getting that happiness, grain, eat, enjoy. But the time is coming. I tell you, time is coming. No one will be escaped. But the thorn, he did not hesitate to give him thorn, the prick. He did not hesitate, because now he is in the net. Why? So the thorns, and that's why he says that I give roses to many and thorns to a few. and no has any right to ask me why I do this. No one has that right to ask him. No one can say that whether you are reasonable or unreasonable, you are fair or unfair. No, it is his will, it is his pleasure to give roses to many. And if he don't, if he does not give roses to many, they will not come towards the net. So ultimately, of course, in order to bring them under in the net, to catch in the net, of course, he has to do such thing. Now there are instances where you find, oh, doing nothing, but of course one gets got realization. Rumi, Maulana Rumi, of course very learned scholar, so many manuscripts he wrote. Wherever he would go, he would take the camels, and on the back of the camels, of course, he would put all the manuscript. And wherever he would go, all respect in this, Maulana Rumi is coming. And Maulana Rumi, of course, very learned scholar. So he would go. Once he was going to some place in the desert. So there was one place, some trees were there, shade was there. So he thought that he should take rest there. So he was taking rest, and the books were still on the back of the camels. So much he had written that not one camel was not sufficient to take the manuscript, but there were several camels. And one madman comes. One mad. And Maulana Rumi got so upset. He said, all this lifelong work, and this madman did this. He was very, very upset and angry. And the madman does not say anything. And what he does, he just goes to the well, and he takes out all the books. Nothing happened to the manuscript. Nothing happened, not a drop of water. And this Maulana was thinking that he was so learned, a spiritual scholar, he cannot do such a thing, and this madman does. Oh, he is something else. His pride just vanished, and he followed him. And that madman who was there, who was he? He was Samstabri, the perfect master. And what he would do? He would give a spiritual lesson, classes, nothing. He would play chess with Maulana Rumi every day. The master would play chess. No talk about God, no talk about anything. Just he would play chess. And every time Rumi, of course, he would lose. And it went on and on and on. And one day, Maulana Rumi was determined that he must win. So he was trying to win, but again lost. And he says, oh, again I lost. And Shamse Tabriz, he says, you did not lose, you won. Immediately got realization while playing the chess. No meditation, nothing. No talk about God, nothing, and got realization. So for him, it is, there are some who just get it. It is his wish, and that's why that grace, it is not that it can fall on anyone. First class is scoundrel, first class sinner. Grace is grace. So there is no reason why it should not fall on the sinners. It can fall on anyone, and that's why that is grace. It is not because someone earns it, and that's why it falls on him. Grace is grace. And that's why that day I gave that example, that the time is coming of his universal manifestation. And at the time, what would happen? His grace will fall like rain. Now, when it falls like rain, when you are open, you are fully, whether in the open saints are there and sinners are there, the grace of course will not make any distinction. If first class sinner is there and the rain falls on him, of course he is fully dead. He will have the full advantage of the grace. Then those who will just go there, oh, it is raining, I must go and see. So they take umbrella and they just go in the open to enjoy the rain. So few drops here and there. Then there are people like this, just like we are sitting here, it is raining, oh, it was very hot, now it is raining, very, very pleasant. Oh, just see, very pleasant rain. So you just see the pleasant, of course, grace is there. You are also benefited by that and you get the inclination to go in the open and enjoy the rain. Then there are others who are just in the closed door, and when they say that, it is raining, it is very pleasant, come out, let us go, let us enjoy the rain. So they hear the voice, they hear that, oh, it is raining. So they try to open the door and come out. Now, those who will be in the open, they will be fully drenched. The grace, they will have the full grace. Those who will take the umbrella, few drops here and there. Those who will be here and seeing the rain outside, it is very pleasant. They will just see, they will feel inclined to go in the open. Those who are in closed door and get the information that yes, it is raining, we must also go and see. So they will just try to open the door. Every one will be inclined to go and see the rain or get drenched with the rain. Every one will have that inclination, but there will be difference in awareness. Awareness, of course, those who will be fully drenched, they will have full grace. Those who will get little drops here and there, they will have less grace, but they will be spiritually inclined, enter into the path. Those who are just watching the rain with the inclination to go there and just get some drops, they will get little less grace, but still is inclined towards the rain. Those who are in the closed door, get the information and feel inclined to come out, they will also have a little grace. And everyone, though there will be difference in awareness, will be inclined towards the rain, means towards the divinity, towards the beloved. So the whole change, total change will be there, and the attitude of the world will be changed. Total change will be there, new order will be established. Now, I tell you certain stories, of course you know how the beloved sometimes feels helpless. Our helplessness in the world, it is helplessness because we expect certain thing and we don't get. So we become helpless, of course we don't get. But this helplessness, it does not give strength, it makes you weak. We say that, oh, hopelessness and helplessness, all the time we must become hopeless and we must become helpless. To become hopeless and helpless, not in words, you are made. Whether you want it or you don't want it, you are made. It is not that, oh, if you have this t-shirt, hopeless, become hopeless. So this helplessness, because we cannot control our wants, desires, expectations, so then of course we think that we are helpless. But what will you achieve? But only through love. When you become helpless through love, then what happens? There is no alternative for you but to follow the beloved. That is real helplessness. Hopelessness, no hope, means no expectation of material or spiritual have nothing, no gain. You just become without hope, but it happens only through love. Love for God. This worldly helplessness and hopelessness, what is the meaning it has? It does not, it gives, it makes you weak. Because you are helpless, you cannot achieve anything, and you think that I am helpless. What is still that helplessness you express, but still the expectation is there. How will you become helpless? Helplessness comes only through love for God. If you have love, then you become helpless. The other day, of course, on Wednesday, the talk on new life is there. So I will explain all this. Helplessness and hopelessness. When you are with the beloved, when you follow his wish, and if you have love, there is no alternative left for you but to follow his wish. If you have that type of helplessness, it gives you strength. And that helplessness, of course, when you have that helplessness, you become not weak but very, very strong. So that type of helplessness and hopelessness, when Baba has asked his Mandali members to lead the life of hopelessness and helplessness during new life, that is that helplessness and hopelessness. Now we have got so many desires, thoughts, expectations. Of course, I don't blame anyone. But when they are there, you are not at fault. But at least, which are against his wish, don't put them into action. And when you don't put them into action, then of course you become footless. Now headless, how will you become headless? The head is full of thoughts, desires, so many things. So headless, but when we love him in the fire of love, everything is burnt up. All the impressions are burnt up. And when they are burnt up, you are headless. So just to become that one part, of course, we should try to do, means the desires and expectations which are against his wish, of course, we should not put them into action. So one part, of course, we can do. Second part, you just say that day I told you, that problems are there, difficulties are there, thoughts are there, this is there, all they are there. Just ask him, oh please don't give your love, we don't want anything from you, we don't want, just give a little slack and the work is done. Just ask for that, just have all the problems will be solved. But just long for that. When we long for that, then of course he is also pleased. It is not that only through thoughts, outwardly you just ask, and then you want something, and you just say, no, I don't want anything. Even you want or you don't want, want is there. You just, one is positive and one is negative. Want is still there. I don't want this. Oh, I am spiritual now. So I don't want worldly pleasure. I am away from that. So you don't want worldly pleasure, still the want is there. So how to get rid of this want? Only through love. Follow his wish. When Baba was contacting during fiery free life, darshan program all over, and out of those 500,000, only one fish is caught in the net. It is just his grace. Not that I was so good or this, atheist I was, I should say. But it is his wish, it is his grace, it is his kindness, it is his compassion that he gave me that opportunity. So for him, there is nothing, sinners, saints, everything, he is in everyone. When he is in everyone, he is everyone, then he cannot ignore anyone. Now I tell you that the story about this rose and thorns. mostly, so all those 500,000 people who had come for his darshan, Baba was giving them roses. Baba was giving them roses, and I came to him. And then when I joined him, he would tell others, those who would come, he is 100% obedient. His love 100%. I did not know love, I did not know obedience. After a few days, 100% obedience and 100% love, what happens? All people, many people had come that day, and Baba was appreciating them, and he says, they are all my jewels, and here is one, he is cold. 100% obedience, 100% love, just for a few days, and then afterwards, they all became his jewels. Those who had come for his darshan, he said, all, they are all my jewels, only one coal is there. I was coal, black. So it happens, because when you are in the net, of course, he can do anything. So roses for them, those 500,000 people who had come at that time, roses, all the time roses, they would write different things, different experiences, different things, and roses were there for them, happy. And of course, when we were there, it is very difficult, rather impossible to be with the master. It is the life just to walk on the edge of the sword. And when your feet are cut, still you enjoy it. It is not that you don't enjoy, but it is impossible thing, and he makes it possible. He makes it possible. Now I just give you an example in the Mandli, Aloba and Kaka. So always in the Mandli, what would happen? That Baba would always keep someone after another one. Always that was Baba's ways. No one could do anything. We were not of our own. Whatever he would say, we would just follow. We would not take one step out of the bungalow without his permission. Nothing. So Aloba, of course, according to Baba's wish, Kaka was after Aloba. And he was skinning him out, eating and drinking and anything, you know, it was so difficult for him. He had to take the dogs for walk, and there were four dogs. One belonged to Mehra, so one should be very careful. So Aloba had to be very careful. 1 hour walk, that means in the morning first he would take Mehra's dog Mastan for a walk. Then of course Mani's dog Peter, so 1 hour Peter. Then Kaka's two dogs, Kaka Barya, one of the Manli. When Aloba would take his dogs, Kaka would take the time. And if Aloba would bring the dogs in 45 minutes, he would say, take back them. 15 minutes, why do you do like this? Poor Aloba, 4 hours in the morning, 4 hours in the evening, 8 hours, taking dogs for walk. And all the time Kaka would be after him, that you did this and you did that. Kaka would serve the food. So he would not serve him, just he would serve him little. He would work and he had to eat little. All the time it went on, not just for a day or two, for months together, years, two years. He was doing in order to please Baba. Kaka was doing this in order to please Baba, and Baba would feel happy, so Kaka would go to any extent. Now, one day, we were in Mandli Hall. Arach was reading the correspondence. Kaka was sitting there. Kaka was the one who came to the West 11 times with Baba. 11 times. Now, when Erich was reading some letter, Baba looked at Kaka and Baba says, do you understand English? Illiterate, do you understand English? Aloba, teach him English. Now Kaka knew better English than Aloba. He went to waste 11 times and Baba says, Aloba, teach English to Kaka. So Aloba was now happy. I am telling this about obedience, means it is not that Kaka was so cruel or this and he was treating Baba's ways, how he would treat the mandli, how would prepare the mandli. So as soon as Baba went for lunch, Aloba gives order to Kaka, so many exercise books, slate, pencil, this keep ready. And the lesson begins. 11 times to waste. He attended the school, everything. But now Aloba started teaching English, A, B, C, D. And A, B, C, D, and he would say, write 10 times. So poor, because it was Baba's order, he would not say to Aloba that I know better English than you. What are you teaching me? I know A, B, C, D. But no word. No word, because Baba had asked him to teach. So Kaka would write A, B, C, D 10 times and Aloba would take round whether he was attending his lesson or not, he was sleeping or what. So he would just, take round, he would not allow him. Then after 10 times, Aloba would go and check. Handwriting is not good. 100 times. 6 months. 6 months Aloba taught Kaka, but no further progress. But Kaka, not a word to Aloba, not a word, because it was Baba's order. He did not say that I know this and what are you going to teach me? I know this A, B, C, D. Old man, and he would just sit in the room and A, B, C, D. And again Aloba would go there and no, handwriting is not good. Write 200 times. Poor Kaka, so busy in that, writing A, B, C, D. This is obedience. Kaka, so old manli, joined Baba in 1928. Whenever Baba would go on tour to West, Kaka should be there. When Baba would go on must tour, Kaka would be there. So must tour and all the time, of course, with Baba, and so obedient. And he was a very strict manager. And because he was very strict, Baba would like him. Pendu was little bit liberal, so Baba would not like him. So Pendu was manager in Mehrabad and he was little bit liberal, means rice and dal. So sometimes he would just give onion, that is extra thing. Baba would not like that. Kaka would not give. If Kaka would ask to give rice and dal, Kaka would just serve less quantity than you need. Baba would feel happy. Very, very strict manager. Now what happened? That all the time Baba would not stay there at Mehrazad. Baba would just go to different places, Dehradun, Satara, Mahabaleswar, Hyderabad. All the time mandli members, means women mandli members would be there. And then Baba would go on tour, must tour. So rarely he was, he would be at Mehrazad. So once we went on tour to Hyderabad, Baba wanted to contact Mast. And on the way, Baba says, now we had to go to Satara, another place. So Baba says, on the way, why not to see Kaka? And we would see Kaka, just stay there for a few hours and then go to Satara. At 2 in the morning, we went to Mehrazad. And what happens? Kaka did not know. All of a sudden, Baba said this, that we should go to Mehrazad. And when we went there, immediately Kaka got up, just opens Baba's room, and what happens? Kept everything ready. Bed was ready, water was ready, everything what Baba would need every day, it was all ready there. It was not that he had to arrange this or that, nothing. Even for tea, he would all every day, even Baba would not be there, he would just keep the milk ready. Everything as if he would expect Baba every day, and we are really amazed. Just he went, opened the then of course, this is our preparation. We must expect him every day. He may come every day at any time. He would not inform you that I am coming to you. So please keep make arrangement for that. He would come at any time. Once it so happened, you must have heard about Saint Gadge Maharaj. He was really a saint. And he was a saint. And of course, he came to Baba. So in 1954, Baba sent me for a few months on lecture tour. And so in one of the places, when I went there, somebody told me that Gadge Maharaj, he was expected there. So I should not, when the gathering would be there, I must give out Baba's message. So I said, all right. So then I went to him, and what he was doing, he was preparing the ground, his followers, they were cleaning and this, everything he would keep, take with him, stage and everything. So when they would go out and when open ground would be there, they would clean the ground and then prepare the stage and everything, and at night his program, means singing program, would begin. So when I went to him, I said, Maharaj, I have come from Meher Baba. So when you start your program, will it be possible for me, for you to give me 10 minutes to say about Meher Baba? He said, of course. And he was sitting on the ground. He asked one chair for me. And I said, no, Maharaj, I am comfortable here with you. He says, if you don't sit on the chair, then I will not give you 10 minutes. So I had to sit there. Now afterwards the program began. About 12,000-13,000 people were there. And then what happens? He started his singing program. It was midnight. I said, this man, he deceived me. I was sitting and sitting there, whether I have come to hear his singing program. This man said that he would give me time, and he is not giving, and he is just doing his singing. So I said, he deceived me, he would not give me time. And I tell you, his singing so profound that when people just felt absorbed in that, this man, he says, now there is one, he has come from Meher Baba. And you just listen to him, about him. And I was just amazed. So I told them about Baba. And then afterwards I left. But then there was this darshan program in at Mehrabad, Ahmednagar, that meeting, September meeting in 1954. So there was one day, darshan program in Ahmednagar. 100,000 people had come. Most of his followers had come there, and this saint, thousands of people would follow him, but the real one, he comes before all these 100,000 people and he bows down at Baba's feet. That is the greatness. Before thousands of people, even his own followers, he comes to Baba and bows down. And Baba just gives him chair, he sit near Baba's feet. And then what happens? That the next day, when Baba left after the program, still the people were there. So he was the one telling them about Baba, and Baba had touched the prasad to distribute. So many people were there and still coming. So then that prasad was distributed, and he told them about Baba. Then the next day he goes to Meherazad. And Meherazad, and he tells Baba that, "Baba, now I am old and I am tired. Please relieve me." And we could not follow what he meant by that. And he says, "Now my work is over, I am old, why not you allow me to be here? I will sweep the ground, keep it clean, give me only one chapati, just allow me to be with you, and I am old, you know, so relieve me." Baba says, "Yes, I will do it. And then, of course, he invited Baba to Pandharpur. That is the place of pilgrimage. Millions of people go there during the fair. And Baba accepted that invitation. Now there was meeting on 29th and 30th of September 54 at Mehrabad. Baba declared at that time that soon he will just relieve Gadge Maharaj. Now then, according to the promise given, Baba went to Pandharpur. And when he went to Pandharpur, millions of people, not just thousands, millions of people. You must have seen the picture, Kumbh Mela. Oh, thousands and thousands of millions. So millions of people were there. And this real saint, he declares that all these years, you were taking the darshan of Krishna in the form of a statue. And today, how fortunate you are that the Krishna has come here in form. How fortunate. So the real one, of course, he knew and he realized. So then, of course, I will come to another one if time permits. So then what happened? Baba came back. Baba said at 12 midnight, he says that Baba says, "Now what is the program?" He says, "Baba, whatever you want." Baba says, no, you invited me. So I am at your disposal. Whatever you want, of course I am ready to do." He says, "No, Baba, whatever you want." Baba says, "Whatever I want to give bath to the lepers." And it was midnight. So Gadge Maharaj says, "Baba, all the lepers must be in the fair. So it is not possible for me to collect, but in the leper asylum tomorrow in the morning, if you want, I can arrange." So Baba says, "All right." So the next day Baba goes to the leper asylum along with Gadge Maharaj, but all the lepers, they had already left for the fair. They were in the fair. Only one leper was there because he was sick, so he could not go. And Baba gave bath to that leper. And you must have seen that picture. Gadge Maharaj was just pouring water, giving water to Baba, helping him. And then Baba came back and entered into seclusion. But before he entered into seclusion, Baba gives us instruction that Gadge Maharaj, no one should be allowed to come here. And if anyone comes, even the message should not be given to me that certain man had come. But if Gadge Maharaj comes, even at midnight, if he comes, you bring him at that time to me. And we could not believe, because when Baba would retire, he would not allow anyone. But he says that even at midnight, if he comes, you bring him to me immediately. So we were waiting for that. I was keeping watch. So I was waiting that Gadge Maharaj would come. Of course, Baba has said, so during his seclusion period, of course, he must come. And he did come. How did he come? He dropped the body. So at any time, of course, Baba said that when he comes, any time, of course, you bring him to me. And he did come. He did come, he dropped the body 2 in the morning, and of course he came there. I was keeping watch, but I could not see him. He did come. Then there was another one. Now this is the real one. Another one when he was in Bombay. So Bombay, and he had big following, just potato. But he would just give spiritual talk, learned person. So people would just follow him, thousands and thousands of following. But conscience at least would prick. I think that Baba was pricking him. So he got the prick and he thought, what to do now? I must go. He came to know about Baba. So I must go to Baba, but I must go, and no one should see. Otherwise he is following his respect. Master he was considered. So he wanted to come alone and nobody should know. So he got an opportunity. Baba went to Sakori at the ashram of Upasani Maharaj, and he came to know. So all alone he comes there. When he comes there, of course he just bows down to Baba. And bows down to Baba, and we did not know who he was. And Baba says, forgiven, my blessing, forgiven. We did not know what sins he had committed. He did not utter a word, but here the Lord forgives him and gives his strength. So, of course, then he left. And then Baba goes to Guru Prasad. Now he had rich followers also. So he comes to Guru Prasad to see Baba. Now the followers were there. So he comes and he shakes hand with Baba. Baba was sitting and he was shaking hand so that his rich follower should know that he has status, big status, spiritual. And Baba, master, Baba was the one who would bow down to everyone, poor, leper, mast, to Mandli members, everyone, and he would feel happy. But here he knew why he was doing that. So he caught hold of his hand and he says, do you know that you had come to Sakori? Yes, Baba, yes, I know, I remember, yes, yes, I had come. Baba says, at that time you bow down to me. So without spending a time, and they must not know that Baba reminded him about that, because they did not know that this man went to Sakori and bowed down. So immediately he bowed down. And when he left, Baba says, purposely I did it. Whether I feel happy when anyone bows down to me, it was not good for him. He has brought his followers to show that he had spiritual status. It was not good for me. Now apparently it would appear, oh, Baba, you know, wanted him to bow down. What a compassion. What a compassion. Once he had come and he had forgiven, and again he started that business. But the compassionate one did not leave him. Now afterwards, his follower comes, very rich one. And he says, Baba, that day I had come with my master, but I am really very happy. I was very happy to see you, and I am really very happy to see. So I have my own plan. If you approve for my spiritual reason, I just want your approval. So what do you want to do? He says, I want to go to some forest. For 1 month, I would remain in seclusion and meditate there. How do you like this? Baba says, very good. He says, but I have got very big business here. Very, very big business here. I would arrange and I would go there, but I would meditate and remain in seclusion. So someone should be there to cook my food. So should I take one cook? Baba says, all right. Take one cook. He says that one cook would be there, but Of course, I am going to the forest and for 1 month, and I am habituated to take certain things fresh. So, whether I should take one station wagon to bring bring the needs from the market every day, Baba says, all right, do it. Then he says that I will be in the forest, and in the forest and there, of course, the tigers may come at night. Should I take my gun? Baba says, all right, to bring the news every day to me. Baba says, all right, do it. And he just went on asking one after another thing, and Baba says, do whatever you like. Whatever you like, I am with you, don't worry. Do whatever you like. So, this is the way we think, whatever we like. Oh, 5 minutes. So, whatever we like, of course, we can go to fulfill our liking to any extent. But when it is against the liking, it becomes too much for us. We have to go against our liking and disliking both. Liking and disliking both, it is only possible through love, otherwise no. And our Lord, He is there. This is that time when even if you don't want, He has to work because He has to manifest through everyone. Just try and see what he does. There was one saint, real saint in Delhi. His Sir Must, he was called. At that time, there was an emperor called Aurangzeb. He was very, very orthodox. Very, very orthodox. And he said, he had announced that every Muslim must go to the mosque and pray. That prayer was compulsory to go to the mosque. Now someone told the emperor that this Sir Must, he does not go to the mosque. They call it kafir. When you don't go to the mosque, kafir means atheist. So he is kafir. So Aurangzeb, emperor, he gave order that must should be taken there, Sir Must should be taken there bodily to the mosque. So he was taken. And that Sheikh Imam means the priest, he started praying. Allahu Akbar means God is great. And here Sir Must, he says, your God is under my feet. And as soon as he said, your God is under my feet, it was too much. And the emperor was informed and he said that just kill him immediately, chop off his head. Within a second, of course, his head was chopped off and his followers were there. When his followers were there, they thought that when here Sir Must, our master, God, he all the time nothing but God, and when he said that your God is under my feet, there must be something. So they went to the emperor and they said that emperor, of course, our master, he was killed. But just this is our prayer, that place where his feet were there, it should be dug. We just suspect something, why he said this. So it was done. And what happens? A vessel of coins. Coins were there in the vessel, it was taken out. Your God is under my feet. So they went to the emperor. And they said, the emperor, now call that Sheikh Imam, priest, and ask him what he was, when he was praying, what he was thinking. So he was called. And the emperor asked him, tell me the truth. What were you thinking at the time of your prayer? When you are praying, God is great. What were you thinking? If you tell me a lie, then your head will also be chopped off. And he says, I was thinking about money. When he was praying, at that time he was thinking about money, and that's why Sarmas says, your God is under my feet. He was thinking about money, money was under his feet. And today, if you go to Delhi, big tomb is there and people follow him. So, what one has to pass through the thorns. Thorns are really very valuable. I tell you, very, very valuable thorn. If you have just one prick, then of course that one prick will be sufficient for you, for us all, because then we just want it to have more and more and more. Our time when Baba was, we were with Baba, and all the time he would tease. When he would tease us, we would not like. When he would stop teasing, that too we would not like. Why Baba has stopped teasing? Whether he loves me or he does not love, so that would be there. Sometimes he would become very, very indifferent. Indifferent for not for one day, but for months together. It was such a time at that time, such a time that one would just die. I would go to him. I would be keeping watch near him, and he would just, when I would go, he would not look at me. When he would want water, he would just do like this, and I would give him water, and he would drink. He would not look at me, and he would give like this. And such indifference in everything, he would not care at all for months and months together. And why he was doing that, he would draw closer and closer. His indifference, of course, would give the vine, and that vine would make suffer and suffer thorns. So we should just, roses, of course, roses are also there, thorns are there. If he is giving the roses, it is all right. And don't forget, get ready that when you are just go near the net, when you are caught, of course, your concern is not there, allow him to twist. Even if you don't allow, he will just feel free to twist your neck, here, there, prick thorns, operate everything he can do. And that is the real thing he will give. That is the real thing. So, even if you just have the thorns, please happy. Feel happy. Don't say that thorns, they are so bad. But don't associate this suffering, worldly suffering, with internal suffering. Because know well, that inner suffering for the beloved, it gives you joy. This worldly suffering, it does not give you joy. And if the joy is not there, know well that this is just worldly suffering. It is not giving me joy. So ask him, please just give me that suffering, so that this suffering and that suffering, of course, here it gives pain and here you give me joy. But that suffering, don't think that because I am suffering, so do not forget to give that suffering. I want the joy of that suffering. Pray to him. He is really compassionate. Most compassionate, what to tell you. He is the only one responsible for everyone. He is with us all. And he will not take rest until the time he takes us to the destination. He is the one. Yeah.